Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you for joining me. So I'm assuming that the people that are here in the audience might maybe know who I am. I'm gonna allow, how many people have seen me in person or online before? Excellent, so I have friends back with me yet again. So I'm a fashion photographer based in New York City, and I've been teaching here at the event space here at B&H for pretty much 7 years at different times. So I know that there's a couple faces that actually saw me back 7 years ago, so I appreciate them coming back as well. Now, although I have been here in New York for about 7 years, I had a portrait studio in upstate New York, and I've had that studio for another 8. So put it all together, I've had a portrait business for 16 years. And so I have shot everything. Everybody, whether you're watching online or you're watching here, I've probably shot something that you do, because I've done photographed children and maternity and family and fashion, and I did photojournalism, and I did a little bit of everything. But eventually I found my calling, you know, my specialty in photography, that thing that when I found it, it just fit in my heart. You know, like you just know that this is the type of photography that you're meant to do. So for that, for me, is fashion and beauty photography. And then also I like to mix in a bit of portraiture. So that's a little bit about my background. But today what I'm actually talking about is creativity. So as I said, I have been in business for 16 years. I've been shooting for longer than that. And I can tell you, I probably didn't really take a good photograph until about 9 years in. Okay, so my point is, what I want to talk about today is creativity, getting the point of taking more than just a technically competent photo. Because nowadays, cameras are great, right? They do a lot of the work for you. It's not that difficult to take a good looking photo, like something that's passable, is good quality, well exposed, decent composition, in focus. With technology, a lot of that's become so much easier. But that's not the hard part anymore. The hard part is standing out and doing something different. In another presentation that I've given, I talk about adding fashion techniques to portraits. But I want to talk about creativity in general today. And in particular, I'm going to talk about in-camera creativity. So without Photoshop, the things that you can do using lighting, using props, using special camera techniques. So that is going to be the focus of today. But what I actually wanted to start with is a presentation that people, it's this topic that people don't really touch on, and it's how do you get to be creative? Because I always used to think you're born with it or you're not. You're creative or you're not. You're an artist or you're not. But that, I don't believe that at all anymore. Especially when I look at my old photographs that were not creative at all. And so I'll give you a little bit of a background on that as well. So let's jump in to creativity. That's where I'm going to start. And then we're going to have live demonstration. And I am going to give you some tips and tricks for things that are simple, inexpensive, that you can do at home, things that work, that are portable, things that can work in the studio, things that can work with natural light. So I'm going to give you a whole bunch of different tips. If anyone would like to reach me after this presentation, the best way to ask me questions is actually on my business Facebook page. I do answer messages there, so feel free to reach out to me in that way. And then also, for everybody, whether you're online or whether you're in person, I have the notes from this presentation available for free for you to download. This will not work if you are outside of the United States, this particular link. So thankfully, you have this video available to watch as well. So both will be helpful to you. So you just text in camera, all one word, to the number 44222 if you're inside the US. All right, so first of all, to start off on an exciting and high note, this is, if you count today as a whole, this is my very first time presenting at B&H as a Canon Explorer of Light. So last year, this time, is when I received that incredible honor. And so today, I'm going to be talking about creativity, but also the tools I use to get creative, including my camera choice, my lens choice, the lights that I'm choosing, and so you can see how those all work together. So thank you to Canon for bringing me here for this presentation. I want to start off with commonly held myths about creativity, things people believe that I believed. So I'm just assuming many of you have these same feelings about creativity. So let me just break apart some myths. The first one, a common myth, is that creativity is expensive, or good imagery or fashion imagery, all of that has to be expensive. I know that I made a ton of excuses for myself when I first started to build my portfolio. I went to school at Syracuse University, and I remember when I took some fashion classes, like I took a class on fashion photography, and I'd look at that image and I'd say, it's beautiful, but I couldn't do that because. Over and over and over again. And basically I'm building up these barriers for why I can't get to there. Instead of breaking apart the photo to figure out how to get to there. It's two totally different approaches. And when you're just starting off in photography or when you're trying to get more creative, sometimes it feels easier to build up the whys that you can't instead of how you can. So I used to say and believe, oh man, they did that because they have an expensive retoucher. They had expensive clothing. They had expensive lighting. They had expensive, that's total crap. Like it's not true at all. And I've realized this with the more experience I had. Several of the things I'm going to do today would cost you nothing to do to be creative. You could light with a single speed light, for example. You could use with something you get at Michael's or AC Moore, simple arts and crafts tools. So for example, this is a beauty shot that I did a couple years ago. And in my portfolio, this received a lot of positive feedback from art directors and from clients. And this is done with window light. So what it is if I'm the photographer, the model's in front of me, and there's a window directly behind me. Then what I did is I went to a florist shop, and we bought this large leaf, which we then pinned in her hair. And the makeup or what she has on her head, it was water-soluble white paint. What's behind her as a background is a painter's drop cloth. So all of it, a leaf from a florist shop, painter's drop cloth, paint, like all of it, and natural light, it cost me almost nothing. And then this is the one that the art directors all responded to. So it wasn't anything expensive or really complicated. Another one is this image. This image, I received a lot of feedback in a positive way. And this cost me nothing. So what this image was a single light off to the right-hand side, a big umbrella with diffusion. So basically, one big softbox, one big light source. That's a really good place to start if you're shooting in the studio, a single light with a large softbox. Okay, how about that outfit? How about this dress? What we did is we took an extra piece of fabric. We tied it around her waist, okay, and cinched it. And then I had extra pieces of tulle from another shoot I had done. So we took those pieces of tulle and we cut them. And then we folded them inside of that fabric so that they overlapped. And now it's a big full skirt. So I had her curl up in a ball on a floor, and we bought at the grocery store bags of flour. And so what I did is I covered her with flour, I put flour in her dress, flour in her hands, and we'd go 1, 2, 3 and pop her up in the air. And it's not a professional model. This is a girl that's a dancer, a ballerina here in New York that I had followed on Instagram, and I reached out and said, would you be interested in posing for me for a shoot? So it's a single light, a homemade skirt, and flour from the grocery store. But it's creative and it's beautiful, but it's also very inexpensive to do. So if you're one of those people making excuses, you shouldn't. All right, now. I feel like this looks like expensive, fancy fashion jewelry, right? Avant-garde appearing in a magazine. What we did is I went around the corner and, okay, I know people online, some people aren't from New York. Don't make excuses, you can get this online. I went to one of those trimming shops, you know, the trimmings for dresses. I went to a trimming shop, and this is actually supposed to be one of the bedazzlings to go around like the center of a prom dress or a wedding dress. So each one of these was between like $12 and $15. So the first one, I put around her neck, and then we used a bobby pin in the back. And the other one we super glued to a cheap pair of sunglasses. But it looks expensive and it looks cool. And the makeup on her face, water-soluble paint. So it's all very simple. What's cool about it, of course, is you know the lighting takes it up a notch, but the actual jewelry, it's not expensive, it's homemade. Homemade to look expensive. So that's myth number one. Creativity and looking like you have expensive photos doesn't actually have to be. All right, my myth number two is that to have creative or good photos, you need to know Photoshop. I'm gonna preface this by saying I recommend you learn Photoshop. Not to save an image, but for me, Photoshop changes how I see the world. Like, I might see an amazing dress, but it's not really a color I like. well, I know I can change the color in Photoshop, not because it's like a cheating thing. It's because I don't have another dress or I don't have the money to. It's fine. You know, it's a tool for you to be creative. That being said, if you don't know Photoshop, that doesn't mean you can't make beautiful images, and it doesn't mean you can't get creative. There are a ton of things you can do in camera, which is what I'm going to show you today, with props and lighting and all of that. So for example, one of the things I'm going to show you today is the example of the picture on the left, multiple exposures in camera. That is 100% in camera. And the picture on the right, everything about this picture is 100% in camera. That blur is in camera. The color is in camera. Like, all of that is captured in camera. You just have to understand your light or exposure or how your camera works. So both of these techniques I am going to show you today in demonstrations. You'll be able to see how both of those work. Here's another one that's done in camera. I'll be demoing that for you as well. It's using mirrors and prisms, but not something specific you have to order online, something you can make yourself, something you can pick up some tools from a local craft shop. So I'll actually break that a piece for you as well. Okay, so now here's the big myth. And this is what we're gonna dive into for a little bit of this presentation. Myth number three is I'm not creative. It's that thing I said in the beginning where you categorize creative people outside of yourself and saying, oh, I can't do that because I'm not that creative. And I'm absolutely one of those people who thought that. When I went to school in high school, there were different tracks you could take, right? You could take, you know, the legal track, you could take business, you could take digital, like tech track, and then there was the art tracks, right? All those different ones. I refused to do photography or art track, even though I loved photography, because I didn't think I was artistic. I approached photography much more in the technical sense. What I liked was the numbers and the exposure and like putting light in a certain place, not the artistic expression. So I actually took not a single photography course, even though they were available at my school. I took digital electronics, computer aided design, because I felt like, yeah, that's what smart people should do. this is what I believed. And I'm not one of those artistic people. And then I was like that for a long time. Periodically, I would come up with a creative image and be like, wow, that was really lucky. That's not really how it works. So what I'm going to talk about is how to make yourself lucky more often, and then it's not luck, right? To keep coming up with creative ideas over and over again. So I just wanted to give you guys an idea of the differences between where my work was and where my work is. Picture on the left. This is a portrait I took of a couple. This was actually an engagement session that I took in 2004. It is correctly exposed. I would say the color balance is not there, like the skin tone's off. The lighting is not bad, but it's not good. But it's like, okay, the couple got an in focus and decently lit shot of themselves. They were happy, so I was happy. But I knew that there was something I could maybe do that was more, but I'm not creative, so I can't do a more creative shot. Like that's kind of how I felt. And then this is a picture that I took last year. I feel like it's a very different photo. It has a very different feel to it, much more creative. And of course, you know, there's technical side of it, but what happened between these two dates? So here's another example here. This was a couple's portrait that I did in 2004. By the way, you see my style beginning, right? I'm working it out there. But again, there's a lot of things that aren't quite refined, whether it's the pose or the lighting, but it's not really creative either, whereas this is a picture that I took a couple years ago. These look like the same photographer's thinking about it, but these are not the same person or at the same level. So the question that I want to discuss is what happened between 2004 and 2014? Like what happened during those 10 years? There's a few things that happened. Number one is time. So if any of you are new starting off and you're like, wow, why can't I take a good... It took me forever. Like, don't rush yourself. Give yourself time and give yourself the ability to practice. In 2004, after that, I went from just taking photos that I knew the formula, light goes here, this is how I focus, to playing. And I failed a lot of really bad photos, but that's what made me learn and when I'd make cool mistakes, all of a sudden it wasn't a mistake, and I'd register it in the back of my mind to use later on. But I made so many mistakes. I was able to go to college for photography, and I also did business and political science, so it was kind of this weird conglomerate of things. But my final year of college, I did 4 hours of studio 4 days a week, where I rented out and all I did was shoot and mess around with the lighting, and that's where I learned the most. It's that practice and making mistakes and being okay with it. As a photographer, I know that I am kind of a control freak, and I feel like some of you can relate to me. Well, I know some of you can, because I know a couple of you. So you're probably control freaks like me, which means you don't necessarily like to play or make mistakes, but that's where you learn. Next thing is education. Coming to things like the B&H event space, or going and watching, this is completely true, way back when, Canon Explorers of Light up on stage at the Photo Expo at the Javits. I've been coming to that since I was in my mid-teens. The education helped me become a better photographer and get more creative. However, this next point is very important, and it is I got rejected a lot and told that I wasn't good enough a lot. And it challenges you, especially if you're as competitive as me. It's that balance of feeling like crap and wanting to give up and saying, no, that person sucks, I'm gonna do better and prove them wrong. Like, I feel like that's the battle that you have when you get critique or when you get rejected. So real quick, my story, which this is what made me a better photographer. I was going to school, I went to school, and I had been shooting at that point for like 8 years, right? So I'm 16 years in now. So I'd been shooting for maybe seven, eight years. And after school, I got a meeting with an art director at a magazine in London. And he invited me in to show my portfolio. So I brought my portfolio in and I showed it to him, and it's print portfolio, and he flips through the whole thing. Doesn't say anything, which is fine. He was looking at it. And he closes it and he passes it back to me. And he looks at me and he goes, I would start again. And I was like, oh, you want to look again? Here you go. And he was like, no, I would do your entire portfolio over again and I would get rid of every picture. And it's not like I'd been shooting 1 or 2 years. I had a college degree and had been shooting 8 years, okay? This is like solidly into shooting. And I like held back tears, kind of tilted my head, and I said, oh, why is that? You know? And he said, here's the thing. Looking at your photos, they're technically competent, right? Well exposed, they're in focus, you got decent posing, like it's fine, but who cares? Who cares? Who cares about a decent photograph? We see decent photographs all the time. If I meet with 10 photographers this week and you leave, the second you leave, I will completely forget you because there's nothing memorable, nothing unique. I was like, oh my gosh. So I did in fact cry hysterically on the walk home. Just so you don't think like I was like, oh, no problem. Like, no, it was dramatic. It was like, it was foggy, right? It's raining. And I had my portfolio and I was weeping and then I'd hold it out over the garbage can and then grasp it to my chest and like weep more. It was very, so like, you know, it was my movie that I've written in my head, but it really was that dramatic. So let's back up or let's continue this. So I was miserable and I didn't shoot for a while. A couple weeks, few months, you know, it was a while before I wanted to shoot. And then I kind of looked at what this guy said. And I guess I get it, right? Like, I mean, sure, if I take a technically competent photo, that's great. But yeah, I mean, how many images and how many photographers do people have to choose from every day? I need something a little bit more for them to remember me or pick me out. Otherwise, what am I working on? I'm trying to maybe bid on lowest price. Like, that's not what I want. I don't want to blend in with everyone else. So what I did is for the next year, I gave myself one self-assignment per week to play, to experiment, to try something new, to fail, to learn something. And so that's something that if you want to know what happened between 2004 and 2014, is someone told me I wasn't good enough, so I shot a lot to figure out where my weaknesses were and to play and to experiment. So, I will tell you, there's a very important other moral of this story. So, 3 years ago, when I became much more successful and I'm doing well in New York and overall, my team and I reached out to this art director over in London and said, hey, you know, Lindsay's doing really great and she teaches a lot. She'd love to get your opinion on her change in her portfolio. And the guy wrote back and he said, I don't care. So my point is, some people are just jerks, okay? And some people just really suck and wanna be mean. So also you gotta know, some people might give you critique just cause they wanna crush you. And you have to know the difference and like when to kind of parse those out. So what I do is I only ask for opinions of people I respect, because then I don't have an excuse to say, well, I don't agree with them. Cause that's what I'll do all the time. Someone gives me critique, I'll say, I don't like this that they do, I don't like this. But when it's someone I respect their work and opinion, I've got to listen. I know, and I liked his publication. So yeah, still a jerk, however. However, there was some point to it. So, all right. So let's start with this first thing, finding your style. Finding your style is one of those things that generally, like for a lot of people, it happens gradually and it kind of just happens. But for me, it was a little bit more purposeful. So let me talk about style. Style is when you look at somebody's photo or you see a photograph and you know the photographer it belongs to without even seeing the credit. Like, it's just that feel. But style doesn't mean that every shot looks like it was from the same shoot. It's like a set of aesthetics that holds throughout. And so the thing is, if a client wants, like for me as a fashion photographer, if a client wants for a fashion shoot, a dramatic, dark, portrait of a man, they're probably going to look for a photographer that has dark, dramatic portraits of men. But if they want something youthful and ethereal of women, they're probably going to look for a photographer who has youthful and ethereal pictures of women. Like, they're not going to think, oh, yes, this photographer's skilled, they can do other things. They're going to look for exactly what they want in your book. So you've got to have a style that sticks in people's mind. People don't remember the everything photographer. They remember, oh, that guy does dark, dramatic portraits of men. That person does soft, ethereal pictures of women. This person is a newborn photographer that uses the cute little props. This is a person who does weddings that has that beautiful lens flare in the shot, that really glowing, romantic look. So you got to have something for them to remember you by. If it's a little bit of everything, there's no way you will stick in your head. And that's what the art director was saying. So let me just give you a quick overview of how I see style. Style is, for me, it's usually 3 to 5 words that when you look at an image describes the following things. Usually one is the subject matter. Sports photographer, portrait photographer, fashion photographer, right? What's the subject matter? And then something usually to do with the way it makes you feel. Playful, mysterious, right? Those kind of words. And then another word for something aesthetic. Colorful, bold, painterly. So it's the subject matter, the way it makes you feel, and then something about how it looks. Now, if you're looking for your own style and you're not quite sure where it is, what I recommend you do is you take a look at the pictures that mean the most to you as an artist, not like ones of a family member, but what are the ones that artistically speak to you? Like, this is me in a photograph. Like, this is what I live for. Pick 3 or 5 of those and see what they have in common. What common visual aesthetics hold them together? Common subject matter hold them together? Common, what is it that holds those together? Because if they're speaking to you and there's something in common, you should probably develop that. You can make it more purposeful. And I eventually did that. And it doesn't mean you can't shoot other things, but it maybe isn't what you present in your portfolio because it mixes up the message. And if any of you have ever done anything with branding and marketing, you want to focus that message. You want it to be very concrete and memorable. So I take really cool, soft, ethereal images sometimes. I just don't put them in my portfolio. I might do it because that's what a client wants. No problem, I can give them what they want, but I don't want to confuse the message. So just to give you a couple examples, here is one of my best friends in the whole wide world, Brooke Shaden, and I asked her to define her style. And she said that her style, when you look at her work, her style is dark painterly. So it's dark images, painterly. It's whimsical, kind of surreal and whimsical, and it's fine art. And so when you look at her images, which I'll show you on the next slide, they all hold together, but it doesn't look like they're from the same shoot. They're dark, whimsical, painterly, fine art. And it all holds together. So if you see one of her images on its own, you know it belongs to her. Another example would be a portrait slash fashion photographer. And so I asked him to describe his work, Chris Knight, and he said his images are dramatic, kind of theatrical dramatic, painterly, timeless, so they're gonna have kind of a longer lasting appearance. And then lastly, portraiture. So let's take a look at what his images look like. So dramatic, painterly, timeless, like none of them look like they're from right now, they were from the past or could be from any time. And they all hold together even though it doesn't look like it's from the same shoot. And then for me, I went through and I defined my style by looking at those images, and I found that all the images were clean, like I controlled every pixel. They're very bold. Something in the pictures jumped out at you, whether it was the pose or the styling or the makeup, and very graphic, graphic compositions, graphic use of the frame. And fashion and beauty photography is my specialty. So none of these look like the same shoot, but they all look like the same photographer, right? So that's the idea behind style. The reason I wanted to cover style is twofold. One, if you don't have a style, even if you're creative, it doesn't really help you professionally. You can be creative, but if no one's remembering you for a certain look, well, then it's just good for you that you're creative, which is fine if you just want to do this for your own fulfillment. The other reason is as you move forward and test some of these creative in-camera techniques I'm going to show you, well, can you use them for your style? Right? You don't need to shoot it just like me. Is there something in the way that you want to shoot? So reinterpret it. It's fine if you go shoot exactly the way I did, but then can you use it another way? And I challenge you to do that. Use it in the way that you shoot. All right, so next thing would be how to come up with creative ideas. Because this is one of those things that no one really explained well to me. I just assumed it was luck. But that's the biggest thing, is creativity isn't luck. It is, in fact, a process. Successful artists have something they revisit each and every time to come up with ideas. Otherwise, they wouldn't be able to make a living out of it. Because they couldn't be like, oh, client needs me to do something creative. Let me just wait till luck hits. Like, so I like to say, you can't wait for your muse, you have to chase it down and then be inspired. So what's great, or maybe not so great for all of you, is everybody has a different process. When I talked to Brooke about her creative process, totally different than mine. If I talk to Chris about his creative process, totally different than mine. But the point is, you got to figure out what yours is, which means you have to ask yourself questions. Those 3 to 5 images that I told you to look at for your style, the ones that are truest to you as an artist, take a look back at them and ask yourself how you ended up with those photos. I'm not even just saying technique, but what gave you the idea? What inspired you? What led you to it? Was it the moment? Was it the clothing? Was it the emotion? What was it? How did you come up with that idea? And start to piece apart what gives you good ideas repeatedly. It's not where you take the ideas from, it's where you take them to. But the important part is you figure out where they did come from so that you can kind of channel that. So I figured out my creative process. And so I'm going to share it with you, but know that yours will be different. Yours will be different, but I just want to show you kind of where mine comes from. All right, inspiration. When I do a fashion shoot, that's my specialty, it could be made up of any one of these things: hair, makeup, wardrobe, subject, location, the Photoshop, whatever. All of these things work together in a fashion shoot. What I do personally is every shoot, I start with one thing: the wardrobe or the makeup, like something I know for certain. Could be an image I find online from another photographer. It could be a keyword that somebody gives me. It could be a makeup artist I work with who gives me a certain hairstyle. That one thing I start with. And then what I do is I build my shoot off of that. I don't try to incorporate a whole bunch of other ideas. Like I build my shoot off of that. So if I know the location and I've got this room that's bright white couches, white wall, white texture, and I'll say, okay, what do I like about that? I love the clean lines of that. And I like that it's high key. So to me, for my style, the best way to shoot that would maybe be, okay, well, my style, maybe I want something to stand out. A bright red dress with a huge headpiece filling that space so I can have her small in the corner, but because she's so bright, it creates visual balance. I totally made that up. I've never used that example before, but I gave myself a scenario and said, what would inspire me? How would I shoot it? Or the other way I'd shoot it would be all white on white on white, so it'd almost blend in, and it'd be hard to see the person. But when you saw them, you couldn't stop looking. Things like that. So I pick one thing and I build off of it. What am I struck by? How does it fit my style? So I've just got a couple examples here to share with you. For example, wardrobe. So my wardrobe stylist sent me a picture of a dress. And the model was walking down the runway and had the dress flipped up. So what I did is I said, she said, we have access to this dress. How do you want to shoot it? I wrote down all of the things that the dress reminded me of. It was purple. The way it was flipped looked like a petal of a flower. And so as I've had these words in front of me, I see purple flower. I said, okay, well, let's shoot it in a lavender field. And I did my research to find a lavender field. It doesn't matter what the creative process is, as long as you've got some way to give yourself ideas. So that's what I would do. I just write down words that came into mind. So purple dress looks like a flower, purple flowers, works great. Or another example is where I grew up on a farm, they had planted all the trees. My grandpa had planted all the trees in a row. And my whole childhood, I was always drawn to this forest. Like, I just thought it was so cool and so surreal. So then I asked myself later on, all right, I want to shoot here. I know this. But I don't want to just have a model with teased out hair and like a futuristic dress. Because why? Why? And that's, I think, one of the weaknesses I see in people's work. When they try to get creative and I look at the photos and it doesn't hold together. Like, why is it like that? So what I ask myself is, why do I like this location? And I've actually used examples from early on in my fashion work as I, like, this is not any of my newer work. It's as I was trying to figure out my creative process. So I would start asking myself questions. The reason I liked this location is I loved the symmetry. I loved the repetition. So what can I do to best show that? More symmetry, more repetition. Symmetrical pose. Having her centered in the frame, repeated lines. So instead of just putting her out there in a futuristic dress and teased hair, which makes no sense, I say, what do I like about a location? How do I channel that? And then this goes on and on. What do I like about this location? I like the reflection. So what I actually did is I shot on a tripod. I shot her once in that room, and I switched her outfit and switched the reflection. Because I'm like, the location's surreal, and I like the reflection. So I want to make an image that plays up the reflections in the surreal. This subject, okay, what inspires me is that beautiful red hair reminds me of Jessica Rabbit. I'm going to shoot her in that style. Or with this subject, I was given a theme, and the theme was Golden Goddess. And so I was thinking, well, goddesses, Greek, like that's been done a million times. How about like an African goddess, like a strong, powerful queen? Let's go for gold, and let's play up gold, gold, everything. The point was I had a theme, and I just started writing things down. And I wrote down Greek, and I wrote down queen, and I wrote down powerful, and I wrote down gold. And so eventually from goddess, I got to golden goddess. It's just because I started to figure out my own process. Or for this one, a hairstylist that I was working with, actually the one that's doing the hair and makeup today, said, let's do, this is, we call this the Rapunzel or sexy cousin it. It's one of the two. But it was actually an inspiration from him. He gave me that inspiration. So that's why it's nice to work with other people. Sometimes we just stay so much by ourselves that we don't get inspiration from other creatives around us. Me being around creatives all the time makes me more creative because I see what they're doing. I'm going, oh man, I need to step up my game. So that's why I like to interact with photographers and other artists. So for my creative process is, what's the foundation of the image? What do I know to be true? What am I drawn to in that thing? The glasses, the headpiece, like what is it that I am inspired by? And then what can I do to incorporate this into my style and really showcase what I'm drawn to? That's my creative process. I have no idea what any of yours will be. But the point is, figure it out. Because when you start piecing it together and figuring it out, that lets you be creative over and over and over again. And then you could actually be professionally creative instead of lightning strike creative. Two totally different things. So I'll just show you a couple more examples. Saw this online. Said, what's the foundation? The foundation is this headpiece. Love this headpiece, super cool. I found it on Etsy. What I often do on Etsy is I reach out to artists that I find or other people online and I'll say, I love this piece, it is striking. But once you sell this piece, if that's the only photo you have of it, you're doing yourself a disservice. You poured your heart and soul into this. It's a piece of artwork. You need a piece of artwork that really showcases this. Let's work together. I can give you a beautiful image if you let me borrow this piece. I'll showcase your artwork as well as mine. So that's how I was able to get this piece to be borrowed. So the foundation is, I love this headpiece. What am I drawn to? I am drawn to the color. So maybe the best way I can showcase that color would be to do more of it. A lot of red, red on red. I'm also, when I'm looking at it, what am I drawn to? Or what does it make me think of? The fans, for me, I kind of thought of like Asian influence. So I selected an Asian model. And then I worked with a makeup artist who took it another level and was able to actually incorporate shapes of the fan. So I start with one thing. What am I drawn to? How can I showcase that? And then also drawing off of other artists. And that's how I kind of come up with a lot of these images. Real quick, before I actually go into demonstration, which I will shortly, I wanted to talk a little bit about my kit so you'll understand the gear that I am using up here and why. So this is typically what you might find in my creative camera bag. Okay, I do have additional gear. I am a gear nerd, so I have a lot. And for those of you who know in New York City, that's not really the most practical of things. So I have my own studio, and one of the main reasons is because I have so much gear. I gotta put it someplace. But I love my gear. And so the main tools that I use. I shoot primarily with a Canon 5D Mark III or a Canon 5DS. And the reason that personally I'm using the 5DS most often, which is what I'll actually be shooting today, is because it is 50.6 megapixels, which means I have a ton of information. And stylistically, I shoot like that headpiece, all of that detail, right? I don't know if I want to capture all of that detail, or if I'm shooting beauty, a close-up of an eye. When I shoot with a macro lens and a 50 megapixel camera, I can make every one of those eyelashes tack sharp and look as thick as a tree trunk when I zoom in. So I like to shoot it for that much resolving power. Next down my line is the two lenses that I use most often would be the Canon 24-70 2.8 and the Canon 70-200 2.8. And the reason I shoot these two lenses is they give me the most versatility, but are also incredible lenses. So for 24-70, I can shoot a wide range of focal lengths and get a wide shot. I can zoom in and get a decent medium to tight shot, whereas my 70-200 is my headshot and my beauty lens. Those are the most popularly used lenses in my bag. Those are the ones I'm grabbing most often. The next two down that would be the Canon 85 1.2 and the Canon 50 1.2. The reason I use those lenses, and I'll be shooting some of them here today, is if I want a really narrow depth of field. Like if I need that narrow depth of field, whether I'm outdoors and perhaps I'm shooting the narrow depth of field to simplify my background, but here today I'm going to be using it for narrow depth of field for a creative effect. I have to have a narrower depth of field than a 4.0 lens, or even perhaps than a 2.0. And so I'll show you exactly why you might choose that lens. And then in the very end, I'm going to be using a 180 millimeter macro lens. And I'll explain why I use this lens, but man, like the detail I can see is beautiful, but I'm going to make the picture interesting by the props that I have. I'm going to use the lens as a tool to capture the detail of that prop. So you'll see that in action. And then today I'm going to be shooting with a couple speed lights. So the Canon speed lights, they're the 600 EX RTs. And for these demonstrations, I'm going to show you how even with just a single speed light, you can make some really cool dramatic effects, even if you don't have a single modifier. There's actually some really creative techniques that you can do. So this can keep it nice and inexpensive, but also very portable, especially if you're somebody that maybe doesn't have a dedicated studio space. So all of these things, remember, creativity doesn't have to be expensive, you don't need a big space, etc. So we're gonna jump into creative approaches. And I'm gonna flip through these images. You're gonna see them in practice. All right, and not all of them, but most of them. Creative approach number one is creative props and tools. So we're gonna take a look at creating mirrors and prisms. So this is all done 100% in camera. Okay, mirrors and prisms. And we're gonna talk about how to do that. That's beautiful for when you want something ethereal or dreamy, maybe in a bridal shoot. This would be for something just surreal and funky. And here's another example. I'll show you all of these. And then this is a prop that we will use at the very end. So let's take a look at couple of these things in action. So my very first demonstration that I'm going to do is going to be shooting with a Canon 5DS, and I'm going to be shooting multiple exposures in camera. I remember way back when I shot film, that a lot of times I'd shoot multiple exposures with my film camera, but then all of a sudden when I had digital, I was just doing it in Photoshop, but I could never get the same look that I wanted. What I really like is when I'm shooting it in camera, I can pre-visualize. Like, I'll show you exactly how this works. I'm gonna be shooting with a Canon 5DS. This will work with a Canon 5D Mark III, and also other brands. If it, check it and see if it has multiple exposures on it. How's that? Other stuff, okay? All right, so let me get this set up. So the very first one, Steven, I'm shooting into that. We're all set. Okay, can I have my lovely model? Hi, Daria. She's so pretty and lovely. All right, right now, although I am using a softbox back here, pretend it's not a softbox, pretend it's a window. This is the point. I wanted to start off with something that you could do even if you did not have a studio strobe, did not have a speed light, you had nothing. But of course, we're in this lovely box of the event space, so we're simulating a window directly behind her. So let me turn this on. And we're going to be using the modeling light. Could I please have the lights off momentarily for this? And everyone online, sorry, but you will be able to see up on the screen, so you'll get an idea of what's going on. Are we good to go, Steven? Okay. All right, so what I'm doing is I am pretending that this is a window, and I am going to shoot her in silhouette. Great. Thank you. So I'm going to turn her to the side, because if I'm shooting her in silhouette, if she's straight on towards me, she's just a blob. You can't see anything of her profile. So by turning her to the side, what I am aiming to do is I am aiming to shoot her underexposed. I don't want to see light on her face. I just want to see the outline of her face, which is why I turned off some of these lights, because they were filling in. This would be something that you could definitely do with a window, but actually, you can shoot this against a bald, overcast sky, right? Just like an overcast day, just underexposed enough. It's just, if it's really cloudy, you start to pick up the textures of the clouds. That can look cool, but in this instance, we're taking a look at a window. How's it going? Good? All right, perfect. So, all right. So I know I'm kind of in the way of my own picture, but you've got them on the sides to look at as well. All right, so I am going to attempt to, I don't have the view on the back of my camera, so that's why I'm looking over my shoulder. Can you look straight ahead for me? That way, perfect. I'm going to try to get, there you go. I'm gonna get a couple shots of her just in silhouette. So let's take a look what this looks like. Okay, I'm going to, this is a tungsten light, so I'm gonna change my white balance to tungsten so I don't have that orange color cast, because we're trying to do this with no Photoshop, right? I don't wanna fix it later, I wanna get it right in camera. So let's see if I can, switch. All right, we're going to go to the light bulb because that is tungsten. And what I'm doing on the back of my camera so you can all see as I'm shooting, and I can shoot in live view, okay? So live view, let's try this again. Live view is letting me look through. My focus. Okay, let's take a look. And I'm gonna hit play and look at, okay, so that works for me. Live view is just letting me actually watch and see what my camera is seeing, and I click when I wanna capture it. So it's not video, it's just the live view mode. All right, so that looks like a good silhouette. I can shoot several of these, because what's great is I can shoot a whole bunch of different poses, full length, put her hand in the, whatever I want, because then later I can select which pictures I want to multiple exposure to. It's not like it has to be in order. I don't have to shoot one photo and then the composite. One photo, right? I can shoot tons, which is really nice. Let's say you shoot a maternity session. You shoot the maternity session, you can do a whole bunch of different poses. Later on, go back and composite onto what we're going to do is flowers, because I think that fits the idea of maternity, but it could be any texture that you like. All right, so let me just shoot one more of these just because I can. And I'm just focusing on her profile. Good, let's make sure it's nice and sharp. All right, great. And I'm gonna hit, so you guys can all see it. Looks great. Okay, I'm gonna have you step out for just a minute. And you can stand wherever you'd like over there. Okay. All right, so the next thing that I need to do is on the back of my camera, I'm going to go to the like creative picture controls. What it looks like on the back of this camera and the 5D Mark III, it's the it's a rectangle with a paintbrush. All right, so think painterly creative, right? So I'm gonna click on that. All right, so it gives me some options here. What I want is the second option I'm dialing here. I want the second one, which is multiple exposure. So when I click on multiple exposure, although it went to sleep, hold on. Click on multiple exposure. I need to enable it. Basically by default, it's turned off, so I need to turn it back on. And now I go down to the bottom and select the base image. So I'm gonna select this photo. So this is what I'm saying, is I could have a ton of different poses. I can scroll back through everything I shot and then pick the photo that I like, that I want to composite with. Calling it compositing, it's in-camera double exposure. All right, so I'm gonna select this one by hitting set. This will be the first image used for the multiple exposure. So it sets this as the base image, and then I can put something else on top. So I'm gonna hit okay. It's thinking. All right, so. Bring them back out. So look what it does for me. It gives me an overlay of her profile so I can see what I'm doing. Wherever it is dark, I will be able to see her. Wherever it is light, it will be see-through for how I have it set up. So let me focus on those flowers. All right, I'm gonna move in a little. Let's see, like right here. Okay, take this, and it's gonna take a second, it's gonna think, and then I'm gonna hit the play button. All right, so then what I can see is, okay, all right, here's what I need to do on the next time around. I can go through the exact same thing. Hit and play again, it's gonna bring it back up. And by the way, it doesn't overwrite your original photo. That original pose is still there. So you'll have the original pose and the one of the flowers and one of them together. All right, so what I see is I need to make sure it's solid on her nose. That looks weird to me. And I want it a little bit more filled in. So Stephen, can you just give me the pretty flower ones? And I'm gonna go more towards the ends, and I don't want so much hole in her head. Okay, so let me give it a try. So I can go back, do the exact same thing again. Hit the, let's go back. Creative picture control, multiple exposure, enable it, go all the way down, select an image. I'm gonna pick a different one. So I want this one. I could do the one before, doesn't matter. So I'm gonna select this one. This will be the first image in the set. I hit okay. I go back to my live view so I can actually see what I'm doing. And also I can lighten it up if I want it to be brighter. So I'm just gonna pump up, lighten up my exposure a little bit. Much better, Steven, that looks good. There we go. I don't want it on her nose. Let's try that one. Let's see. Moment of truth. You know, so then you can move it in and out and do whatever you'd like, okay? So I'm of course using flowers, but this could be, I mean, it could be anything. What I've seen that's been really interesting is people have done this with the New York skyline. And the New York skyline looks really, really beautiful. I've also seen it with mountaintops and trees. I've also seen it with the waves on the edge of the ocean. So what you'll see is the profile, and then the back of the head is the edge of the ocean. So my argument to you is, sure, feel free to try it with flowers, but what fits your style? And maybe it's maternity would be, or maybe you're shooting children, or this is beautiful for bridal images. So try to use it for your own specialty. All right, so I'm gonna pause momentarily and see if there are any questions based on the multiple exposures.
In order to do the multiple exposures, you have to have a camera that has that capability.
Yes, so the question was.
Okay, that's a 5D.
Uh-huh.
What if you've got a 40D? 40D does not have that capability.
No. So, all right, the question was, in order to be able to do this technique, you have to have a camera that does multiple exposures. And the answer is yes. However, if you happen to have a camera that doesn't do it, this is completely possible in Photoshop. But for those of you who are not Photoshop savvy, and you perhaps want to get it right in camera, then this would be a better option. But you absolutely can do it in Photoshop. Not Lightroom, but yes, Photoshop.
Okay, but you cannot do that if you don't have a camera that has a camera.
Correct, correct. I'll take one more question. Yes?
Are both of those pictures raw?
Yes, both of those pictures are raw. Even the composited one. No, he says no.
I think there's JPEGs. They're composite as JPEG.
He says the composite is JPEG. I listen to the boss. When I am shooting these, what I've done in the past is I've opened it up in Photoshop, and then in Photoshop you've got the ability, like under filters, and then you can use the camera raw filters to adjust it like you would a raw. That makes sense? It's the two images together. All right, so because of time, I'm gonna keep moving. So Steven, I'm gonna have you switch things up. And I would like to start, our next one is going to be, so this was pretending to be a window, right? This is with natural light, a bald sky. We're going to move on to a single bare speed light. And you guys can bring the lights back up if you would like. So I'm just gonna move some stuff around. We're changing our styling a little bit here. Great. So being queen of excuses, same thing, when I used to have a single speed light, I'd be like, well, what are you gonna do with that? I can't get creative. But of course, you can. So I'm gonna show you a couple examples of how you might do that. All right, so good. And
pull up your light room.
I can do that. Let me grab my trigger. Beautiful. All right, what I'm going to do is I am going to base this upon my understanding of the sun. Okay, have you guys ever seen in pictures out on the beach where you see the shadow of the palm trees on the beach, right? And you see that beautiful pattern. And I've seen a really, like quite a few beautiful photos when they have the subject lay in that pattern. And it's beautiful because it's casting an interesting shadow. But unfortunately, we New Yorkers don't really live in palm tree beach area to get that same effect. But what it really is, it's the idea of the direct sun casting a shadow on something. So how do you do that and take control? So what we're going to do is we're going to emulate the sun. What the sun is, it's a harsh light source that relative to our subject is really small. Although this isn't a lighting course, the idea behind it is the smaller a light source is compared to the size of your subject, the harder the lines will be in the shadows. So that's like a rule of lighting. So if I've got size of the head of a speed light is quite small compared to her. And the further back I back it up, it becomes smaller and smaller and smaller relative to her, which means the lines become harder and harder and harder. So what I can then do is I can put something in between the light and the model, and all of a sudden I can cast interesting shadows, interesting patterns. So that is what we're going to do for this first demonstration. Okay? And that's all good. Great. I'm going to back you up just a little bit. Okay? Great. All right, so we're going to use a single speed light here. And we're at, right, it's acting like the sun, high from above, relatively small compared to the size of her face. And again, we're using the Canon 600. So pop that up for me. And what I'm doing is I'm using a $12 parasol from Amazon.com, okay? But if you're lucky enough to live in New York, we have a fabulous fashion district that has, particularly the fabric, that has amazing lace shops, shops that just sell lace of all different shapes. So what we're gonna do is we're going to put it in between the subject and the light. I'm gonna have you look straight here and just a little, maybe chin there a little bit. Turn your shoulders that way as well. Great, you're gonna stand, what? Oh, gonna, talk to me.
I was gonna say, remember to change your white balance.
Great, okay, perfect. All right, so actually I'm gonna have you hold it out first. I'm gonna show you what not to do first. Okay, so I know that I'm not, what you're not supposed to do. Okay. Let's make sure this is all on. Okay, it says no camera detected. Let me make sure that it turns on. I let it go to sleep for a second. On. What do we have going on here, Stephen, in the Lightroom? There we go. Okay, it was like to sleep. All right. So I'm actually right now going to be tethering into Lightroom, and I am shooting raw files. And so it'll take a little bit because they're 50.6 megapixel files. Let me open this up. All right. And I'm going to switch my white balance back. Let me just open this up again. Let's tether capture. Beautiful. Okay, so I'm gonna switch my white balance back because the speed lights are daylight balanced. Or in this case, I'm gonna turn to flash, very similar. And I am going to get a test shot first. And Steven, you are in my photo, so just angle. Yeah, okay, good, let me test this. Let's get a test shot. And with no umbrella first, okay? Just make sure everything's turned on, okay? Oh, hey, hold on. Make sure it's the right one. Perfect. Okay. So let me get a quick test. Hold on. There you go. And let me check one more thing. All right, good. Testing. Good. All right, let me explain one concept to you. All right, so here's the deal. This is gonna be really hard light on our face. If I have this parasol far away from her face, what ends up happening is the lines are not very crisp because they go through the parasol and they have time to spread out. That makes sense? The light wraps around and they have time to diffuse. So the closer that you bring this parasol to her face, the more crisp the lines will be. Also, pull this real quick. You're going to want to emulate the sun in the fact that we've got that speed light quite high. Because if it is low, you'd have to have the parasol in front of her face for it to cast shadows. So by having it high up, it'll cast the shadows down. What this means to you guys as a possible problem is if she has her, if it's really high up and she has her head straight forward, you'll get some shadows in the eyes. So what you may do as a solution is you may just tilt the chin up just a little bit to catch that light, because you need the high angle to cast those shadows down, all right? We're going to use the same concept in a second as well to show you how the same idea can be used over and over again. For example, in the next demonstration, we're using the exact same idea, the exact same idea. Here it's going to cast shadows on the face. In the next demo, we're going to cast color. All right, the tool that I have in my hand right now, this is something that I bought at Canal Plastics down on Canal Street. Okay, everyone online, oh, we don't have Canal Plastics. You can buy it online, okay? But you could also just take a creative color gel, like Roscoe. Roscoe makes a series of gels. You could use those gels. You can even cut a hole out of the center of those. We're going to use this to create crisp lines on the face. All right, so let me, real quick, do my test shot. And I need my, there we go, perfect. I'm going to need my spider holster on this next one. Okay, so let's make sure we're still tethered. Okay, so this is with the speed light just over her head. I need to keep it open. Now hold it real close to the speed light, okay? And hold it down, ready? Right here. It looks like it went through almost nothing. You'll see it be like a little bit darker and you see a little bit of texture. Okay, that was the distance here. Watch the huge difference. Bring it super close, just drop this so you have extra hands. All right, real close here. Okay, let's test this. Okay, looking better. It's gonna load up. Okay, I'm getting some texture on her face. I'm gonna change the angle of it a little bit, I think. Let's see, right. I'm gonna lower it just a little bit. Let's try there. Okay, and bring it really close. Okay, right there is perfect. Real close. Okay, hold that for me. You're good, you keep backing up. Stay right there. All right, so I'm literally just gonna have it barely in my frame. Good, just like that. Good. Ooh, pretty. Okay, ooh, pretty. Okay. And now the lines will be much more crisp. So look at that texture on her forehead. It's beautiful. And I can also change it to black and white and just make it about the pattern if I want. So I'm gonna take one more of those just because I like it. Okay, do one more. I want that pattern. I wanna see if I can get that pattern here. So I'm gonna try to move the pattern a little bit more over the eye. Okay, hold it right there, Steven. Okay, just like that's great. Ooh, pretty, okay. I like it, and I can see it. So you'll see what the pattern does now. So just it moves it down a little bit and I can have across her face. If I don't want to see the parasol on the shot, I have a couple solutions. Right now, I'm shooting with the 85. Let me just move this down. I'm shooting with the 85 1.2. But another thing I could do is I could use a longer lens, maybe the 70 to 200 to crop in tighter if I didn't want to see the parasol, or a 180 millimeter macro lens. Because then I could just get in just to her face and only get that texture on her face and not see any of the rest of the composition. All right, let's see. So change it to black and white, pop the contrast. And that's creative and beautiful with a single bare speed light and a $12 parasol. So we're going to base off of that exact same concept our very next shot. So let's grab that gel for me, Steven. All right, so in this case, I got the cutout from Canal Plastics. It's just a piece of orange plastic, and it's a little bit thick, but like I said, it can just be a gel. It doesn't really matter what it is. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna put it in between the light and her face. Closer it is to her face, the stronger the line's going to be. Now, right now in this room, it's a little bit hard to be able to see this, but what I have on my camera, there's a button that's next to the lens that is not the one that makes the lens fall off. The other one, okay? I just forewarned you, not the other, like, okay? This one, back in the film days, what I used it for, it was depth of field preview button. Well, people remember, right? I started way back when with like flowers and macro shots, and I would hold it in and it would give me a preview of what the aperture would actually look like once I'd taken the photograph. That was the idea back in the film days. Well, now when I hold it down, it gives me a modeling light. So watch the speed light. Oh. Yeah, but do you guys see what it's doing? Watch your face. You see it? Looks super cool. So I'm actually, can I have my macro lens? I know the interest that I want is right here. Like I don't need to see the rest. And so this comes out again. What's the point of this photograph? It's going to be the color and the detail. I don't need to see everything. So I'm going to use my 180 macro lens. We're going to come in close and just get that interesting shape. The reason I use the 180, there's two lenses that I really like for macro. There's a Canon 100 millimeter macro and a 180. The 100 is sharp and gorgeous and amazing. One of the reasons I use the 180 is it gives me a little bit more working distance, so I don't have to be quite as close to the subject, which is nice because maybe if I gotta be real close for a shot, I might get in the way of my light. I mean, I like them both, but this one gives me a little more space for this particular instance. So, all right, bring it back, Steven. I'm gonna get my focus. Beautiful, let me check my modeling light. Yeah, okay, perfect. Okay, try a couple shots. Ooh, I like it. All right, one more. See right there? Good. Right there. Let's check this one. So I'm gonna check this next shot. I just shot over on that side. Let's let's see, change my composition up a little bit. And I've got a little bit of ambient light, so I'm going to change my shutter speed. Let's see. I'm going to cut out some ambient light here. Do it one more time. And let me stay right there. Yeah. Bring it down. Bring it so that it's maybe I'm using that. Yeah, right there. That was good, Steven. Good. Okay. Perfect. It's beautiful. Stay right there. And I'm moving the focusing points on the back. Oh, you're in my way, Steven. Right there. You're good. Moving the focusing points so it's focused on her eye. Oh, you're a little off. Move it over to the left more. Keep going, and raise it up a little bit. Yeah, it'll be cool. So you guys are getting the idea. So, next one, you'll see what the change was doing. So I could put a streak across her face, across her eye. This just happens to be with one gel. I can grab 2, 3, 4 different colors, stack it in different ways, cut out different shapes. I could cut out a lightning bolt if I wanted a lightning bolt. Whatever you want, the point is to get creative. So the idea of what makes this shot work and the last shot work, the bare speed light, small light source, relatively small and relatively far away from my subject, and then keeping whatever you want to cast a shape close to the subject so it is very, very crisp. And the change I made before, if you noticed, is that I switched and changed my shutter speed because I was getting some of this ambient light. This isn't necessarily a lighting class, I just wanted to let you know what that change was. So let me pause for a second before we move on to the next concept and see if there are any questions about this one. Peeking. Yes?
If you're shooting outside and the sun is a real hot light source,
yes.
What time of the day would be best to pull something like this?
Great. Okay, so the question was, what time of the day would be best if you were doing this outside? Because you can absolutely do the same thing with the sun. Like if you had that bright sunlight and you wanted to come outside and do it, here's the thing, noon is a little bit harder because if the subject's looking straight on, you will have dark shadows in the eyes. However, you can still do noon if you got up at a little bit of a higher angle and had them raise their chin. So what it has to do with is the angle of the sun and where you place their face. I'm still gonna say around midday, you know, 11 to 2, because if it gets too low, then it's not cast in the pattern in a way that'll actually not be in your composition. It's still gotta be high up. So midday, we'll do the same for both. Okay. And she said the model's going to squint. So that's also actually, but that makes a perfect point though for why a speed light's going to be a great solution, because you don't have to worry in the middle of the day she's squinting, or it's hot and you see sweat on the face. It's a controlled environment. And I mean, look how much space this takes me. You can shoot this with a speed light in any room. I mean, I could shoot this in a bathroom, and the background's not in the shot, so it doesn't matter, and it still looks like a beautiful photo. Okay, I can help it. I want one more just so that I can have it, and then we'll move on to the next one. Okay, I'm going to shoot this. Okay, ready, Steven? Turn your chin back that way. Roll it back this way. Okay. You got to go like this. Yeah, right there. Yeah. You guys can see it, right? The modeling light there. Okay, don't move, hold real still. And I'm changing my focus points. Okay, that'll be good. Yeah, I like that one, good. All right, perfect. So we can switch up to the next light, right? Cool? But nice and sharp in the eyes and on the face, but look at the macro lens with that narrow depth of field that kind of melts away. Really pretty. All right, so the next shot, what we're gonna do is we're actually going to add a modifier to our speed light. And in this case, what I'm going to do is we're going to use something called a rapid box that Westcott makes. Basically, it's going to turn our speed light into a soft box. So I have much, if you look here, can you see how hard the shadows are? That's on purpose. Now we're gonna go in opposite direction. We want it to be more flattering on the skin. So the idea was the smaller the light source relative to the subject gave you hard light. Well, now we made the light source bigger relative to her, right? Bigger compared to her face. So I'm just gonna take a test shot and then we're gonna talk about making it creative.
Do you want the same lens or the same lens?
Great point, I want a different lens. Can I have, let's try the 85. So I was shooting with the Canon 180 macro lens and now we're switching back to the 85 1.2. Where's my, there we go. Okay, so what we're gonna do is we're actually going to take a look. Let me take my test shot, make sure my angle's right. You gotta turn that on for me. Great. And let's check time. How we doing? Doing great. All right. Bring it right there. It's perfect. I'm just gonna grab a quick test shot. Perfect. Look right at me. Beautiful. All right, so take a look when this pops up how much softer it is. But it doesn't really look any different than a soft box would be with a studio strobe because it's the same idea. The light source is going to be the same quality or very similar quality of a studio strobe with the same size modifier, but it's much more portable. So let's talk about next thing to get creative. Okay, I bought three pieces of mirror, okay? Three pieces of mirror, and then duct tape them, gaffers tape them, whatever you want together, and made a prism. And it costs almost nothing. I have also made this when I've traveled and didn't want to bring this with me because I'm going to break it. I've gone and gotten the little mirrors that they have that are intended for wedding table settings. At like AC Moore Michaels, you know what I'm talking about? You put the candles on it. I've taken three of those and just duct taped them together. And it makes a prism. So what I can do is I can shoot through this and create really interesting results. Well, let me move my focus point. Great. I'm balancing this. Great. Okay, so this is what this, and this costs like what, 10 bucks? 10 bucks to make?
Oh, wow.
Right, really cool. So here's what you need to know if you do this. The wider angle lens you use, if I use a 24 millimeter lens in here, the more reflections I see. Because it's actually looking wider inside and it sees more and more and more reflections. The longer lens I use, so this is an 85, I'm only seeing the immediate reflections around her. But also, because I'm shooting, right now I believe I'm shooting at 4.0, because I'm shooting at 4.0, the edges are out of focus, so it looks like it all blends together. If I were shooting, say, at f16, I'd see the edges and it makes for a really cool effect. Also, not only focal length, but if you have your lens further back, it does something completely different than if I have my lens right up against it. Let's see. All right, where do I want the angle? Good. Hey, Steven. Right? It's really, really beautiful. I want to do one. Can you just give me 24-70 real quick? I'm just going to get one shot where I can show you a little bit wider. All right. And so I was shooting at 1/200th of a second, 4.0, with the 85 1.2. It's so pretty. Okay. Now here's one other cool variation of this. I got very ambitious. And what I did is I went down to the, well, I went specifically to Canal Plastics, but any place that sells mirrors or plexi, and I had them give me three pieces of 2-foot by 2-foot mirrored plexi, and I taped them together so I can put my model in it. And all of a sudden, she's touching her own reflection because she can reach her arm inside. Super cool. That whole setup, I believe, cost me about $80. I put it together, we super glued the edges, and then duct taped it. So that's a little more expensive than our $10 solution, but still super cool. All right, so let me try one more of these. What's that? I do, it's up top in the equipment room. All right, let's see. So let me make sure my focus point is in the middle. Great. I'm moving my focus point in the middle because I don't want to focus on reflections that aren't her. Holding this up. Cool. See, there's not too much in the room to actually reflect, but you'll get the idea. See how it like has all those reflections? So if I shot you guys, I'd be able to see multiple reflections over and over again. So that shot that I had in the beginning where the girl was centered and then it had all the triangles, it's shooting with 24 instead of 85. Okay. I'm going to switch to this with you. And I'm going to switch back. Right, I'm going to show you one more thing playing with prisms, then I'll take questions after that. All right, so again, that was like, what, $10? Inexpensive, but super cool. Do it yourself. The next variation of this. Next variation of this is to buy a crystal. So this is a chandelier teardrop crystal, or chandelier crystal. This particular one I bought on eBay for $6. So again, not an expensive solution. If you live in an area with a lot of antique shops, they'll often have crystals, but then they also sell these on both eBay regularly as well as Etsy. What I can do with this is I, outdoors, can hold it against the edge of my lens and create a little blur. Or I can hold it completely in front of my lens, and you can see what it's doing. It breaks up the image. And that's what I showed you in some of those shots that were soft and ethereal, and I'm shooting right through it. But a couple things you want to know. The further you hold it away from your lens, the more you will see the outline and shape of it. So it becomes apparent what you're doing. Really, you want to hold it basically right up against your lens. And that obscures it, so you just see the abstractions that it does. Also, because you're shooting through a thick piece of glass, your picture will no longer be tack sharp. I'm just telling, like, it's not going to be tack sharp anymore. But you have to be perhaps okay with that if you're going for soft and ethereal. Like, that's the trade-off. So let's take a look at what this looks like. I'm going to do one without. You're going to have to turn your chin this way just a little bit. Good. Great. So this is without. Okay. And now let's do with. Okay. Next one. So it like breaks it up in a million ways. But everywhere that I move it puts a different effect. So, for example, let's do. And I'm focusing and then putting it back over, because what'll happen is it might try to focus in it. So I focus. I use my back button focus to lock the focus in place. I hold it down, and then I put the crystal back on. But each and every time I move it around, it does something different. So $6 crystal from eBay or Etsy. So for a moment, I'm going to have you guys, if you'll set up that second light, see if you guys have any questions on what we just did. The mirror, as well as the, you gotta pull it this way, as well as the crystal. No? Everybody good? I'm that good? All right, perfect. I'll take it. Listen, whatever. All right, next thing. All right, we're stepping on down the line. We're going for inexpensive. My point here was inexpensive, simple. Up to this point, we've used a single speed light, which makes it very, very portable, very simple to work with. I'm sure many of you own a single speed light. But there are reasons where you might want to step it up. Okay, so next super inexpensive tool that you can purchase at Acemore, Michaels, whatever. They're little gems on a clear piece of plastic. I'm not really sure why they exist, but they exist. I don't know. But anyway, here's what we're going to do. Do you guys know, like, have you ever shot a really narrow depth of field picture with like holiday lights in the background? And it makes those big bubbles, like, really, really beautiful. Or maybe you've shot, I've done this before, where I've shot during the day where there's maybe water in the background with the sun hitting it, and when it goes out of focus, it makes the big, right? So the bokeh. What we're going to do is create that in a studio or in a speed light studio situation. Because I only ever see that stuff outdoors or with a light source. What I'm going to do is I'm going to make this my little blurry bubbles, okay? And what we're going to do is I'm going to do one without, I'm going to have you move this back this way. Okay. Take one. Just like this. Oh, wait, bring it back. Not that far. Bring it back. Okay, can we turn it off for a sec? Just kill it for a sec? All right, so I'm gonna take one with this. And the further I have it away from my lens, the more defined it is. The closer I bring it, the more out of focus it'll be. Okay? So, let's take a look here. I'm gonna take this and put it in front of my lens. I know this is bad, it's on purpose, I swear. Okay, you'll see. What do you see?
Nothing.
Almost nothing. I can barely see a little bit of purple here and a little bit over her eye, but that's not doing me any good because I'm in a controlled situation where I'm exposing for the light on her face. There's nothing hitting here. You gotta have light on it for it to sparkle. So, this is why I would add a second speed light, so you can flip that back on for me. That speed light, I am going to set to a very low power, so all it's doing is just a kiss of light to give it sparkle. But I can't be shooting at f16, because at f16 or f11 or at whatever, it's gonna be really sharp, so you'll just see them. I need to be shooting wider, so maybe, like I'll try it at f4, and see if it's wide enough. I might need to go to 2.8 to 3.5 and it'll just make these beautiful little blurry bubbles. How I've used this before is if I've got pink and purple here, then I'll have like pink and purple in the makeup or pink and purple in the background. It just sets the mood. So it's just the second light is intended and everything good. So just to make sure, I'm gonna make sure it's hitting this. Perfect, right? Did my little test. So let's see. Yeah, okay. So it makes all the little dreamy bubbles, right? And it's something that I actually never saw in the studio. I only ever saw it outside. But so it's, you take your second speed light for a little kiss of light, and then these, I think, were $2.99. And let me just do one more. Back up just a little bit more. I'm gonna open up my aperture a little bit, so it's a little bit blurrier, and bring it real close. And I'm gonna put it further in front of the shot, just so I can make it really, really bubbly. Let's see. Maybe that was a little bit too bubbly. First one was better bubbly. Okay, it's cool. Next one was less, not so better bubbly. But the point is I'm moving around, I'm trying different things, depending on the angle, depending on my aperture. Like, but notice the wider aperture made the bubbles bigger. Yeah. Smaller aperture makes them smaller. So just know that when you test it out. Okay? And you can also do this. Yeah, and go back to the first one. Just watch the bubbles, see how smaller, they're a lot smaller. Know that you can do this outdoors, but it's much harder to control things because you have to make sure some light's hitting it. Like, I like having this nice controlled situation here. So, all right, with that, let me see what I'm thinking. Were there any other ones that I did? All right, so, no, I didn't mean done. I meant done with speed lights. So, we just did, if you took a look at these, we actually just did several different looks, whether with a prism or a mirror, or a gel, or like, these are a lot of different in-camera creative effects, and those were all done, that first shot was either with natural light, and this was all done with speed lights. So if you're the type of photographer that wants to have a portable studio, perhaps, or maybe you're in a smaller space, speed lights are going to be a perfect solution. And especially if you're a wedding photographer, I mean, you're gonna live and die by your speed lights. It doesn't mean you can't do awesome creative studio setups as well. All right, that being said, I'm going to demonstrate just a couple more things if we're switching over into studio strobe mode. But please know, the more you know your lighting, what I'm going to show you here with studio strobes, you can do with speed lights. I'll tell you the one like trick thing that you might need to be able to do. I'll tell you what tools you'd need to be able to do. It's workable. Actually, that's perfect. All right. I am going to have you go change into this dress, please. Okay? That'd be wonderful. All right. What we're going to do for our first shot is we are going to do Let's do the constant and strobe mix. All right. I am going to be a little complicated. Okay? Because I wanted to, like, we start off really basic, right? Really simple. A lot of really easy to understand concept. But I wanted to take it up a notch. And by the way, the concept that I am talking about right now, if you watch this and go, okay, wait, what? if you go to this site, learn.lindsayadlerphotography.com, there is a completely free, totally 100% free, 40-minute tutorial, and part of it covers this technique. It's free, it walks you through step by step. So this is, just so you know what it's called, we're using constant light and studio strobe mixed together. All right. Now, what you might be familiar with this is, have any of you shot, let's say, a wedding or an event in the evening, okay? Where you take a picture with your speed light and your subject freezes in place, but then the background, you see movement. Have you ever seen that? So the common term for this is called dragging the shutter. You have a longer shutter speed, and what happens is your speed light freezes your subject in place. But your long shutter speed allows the light in the background to register. And as you move your camera or as the people in the background move, it creates a blur. Because that's what's lighting them, not the speed light that freezes your subjects in place. So you can do that on location and event photography. But here, what we're going to do is we are going to recreate that technique in a studio situation. So I'm actually going to make Steven sit in for me while we wait for our model to change. Love you, Steven. he didn't even, he's like, whatever, it's fine. It's because, and I'm gonna switch my lens. Hold on. Can I have a 24 to 70? Great. I'm gonna switch to my 24 to 70 because here's the key for this shot. It's recommended to have a zoom lens, and you'll see why. So just keep this in your mind later on. If you're trying this with a prime, it's going to be a pain. Zoom lens is what you want. And I use the 24 to 70 because I'm going to be zoomed back a bit. So let me pass this lens off to you. All right, great. Do you have another stand, or do we need one?
I have one.
OK, great. All right, so let me just tell you real quick the lighting that I have set up while he gets this second one. The main light that we're going to have, it doesn't matter what your modifier is, but you don't want it to be a big light source, like a big softbox. The idea if you're recreating this is you want to have a narrower light source, perhaps maybe a grid on the face or a zoom reflector. You don't want her to be lit by strobe head to toe, because that will freeze. Any place this lights will freeze in place. I need something that's not going to freeze, because that's where I get my interesting blur. All right? I'm going to break this down step by step now that she's coming back. Perfect. All right. And I need my other trigger as well.
It's right there. I've got it for
you. No problem. Okay, I'm just going to have you stand. Sorry, babe. I like your shoes with that.
Yeah, no.
They're fabulous. Okay. She's got her sneakers on. She's adorable. I will eventually. Okay, let's switch. So let's switch over. Perfect. Thank you. Okay, guys, we're going step by step with this. And I'm going to just raise this up a little bit. All right, come forward for me. And you're going to turn your body away from me. And can you turn that modeling light up? I can't see what's going on. One of the things I like about shooting studio strobes is using modeling lights, right? So modeling lights, what you see right there, that's not what we're actually exposing with, but that's what I'm able to see with. I can actually envision where the light is going to go. However, you guys probably can't see that at all because we've got really strong lights on. All right, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to ask to have the house lights down, please. You guys are going to lose your ability to see me, but I don't think that's such a shame. All right, so here's what we've got going on. I've got a beauty dish with a grid. What it does is it restricts the light. You can see right here what is actually going to be frozen in place, because that's what's lit. The modeling light is showing you. So I've got light from her face. By the time I reach her hip, there's no light at all. So it's very restricted light. This is what I want. So I'm gonna take my first picture on my normal studio strobe settings, which for me is 1/200th of a second. The reason this is that's my camera's sync speed. When I shoot at a higher sync speed, it cuts out ambient light. It cuts out light in the room. There's not too much in here right now, but that's something I often do so I don't get weird light I didn't intend. So let's take a look. And what is that at?
6.4.
Turn up a little. 6.8. Right there. Okay. Let me give this a quick test. I'll adjust this. I lied. Go up to... Oh, wait. Hold on. Yeah, go up a tiny bit. 7. Right there. All right. One more. I'm going to do a full length shot. Here we go. Okay. And double click on the next shot. Perfect. I'm in the way. Okay, so this is showing you what it's lighting. The beauty dish is just lighting to about her midsection. I know that because I put her in a sparkly dress, what I envision in the end is for the light of the dress to sparkle and move. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to turn on a second light. I'm going to turn on this light down here to light the bottom half of the dress. Okay, good. But the key is this one should not flash. Because if it flashes, it freezes the bottom of the dress. What I need for it to do is just give me a modeling light. And then I'm going to have some movement. So let me just show you. Got the main light on, it froze her in place. I turned this one on, but this will not flash. It's just the modeling light. So let me take another picture. Exact same camera settings, nothing changes. So, all right, exact same. All right, what difference do you see? Like nothing, right? Almost nothing? Almost nothing because I have a fast shutter speed. And this right here is a constant light, so it's not picking up. What I just did is I turned up the power of the modeling light. Let's try it again. Let's see if it's any stronger, okay? Turn the modeling light up to full power. All right, watch the dress. It's gonna click over. Helped a little bit. I've done, oh man, what else could I do to make it brighter? I guess I could bring it in. The solution is not in the power of this light. Sorry, all of you that's getting blinded. It's in your shutter speed. When I have a long shutter speed, it lets this light record. It lets it show up. So I'm gonna go from a 200th of a second all the way down to say, let's do an eighth of a second, okay? An eighth of a second. So it's gonna go real long, okay? Real long. Okay. All right, so now watch what you see at the bottom of the dress. From a 1/200th to an eighth of a second. Oh, now I can see your dress. Okay, cool. But, and her sneakers, it's okay. But right now we're not seeing the sparkle, like the movement of it. I need something else. So Steven, you're gonna be my movement. So what Steven's gonna do is he's gonna throw the dress. He's gonna add some movement. And if I want this to be less bright, I could either turn down the power of the modeling light or faster shutter speed. The longer the shutter speed is, the brighter that gets. So let's do...
Lower on the face and all.
We'll get there. You're fine, babe, thank you. All right, so I turned down the power a little bit. All right, so now, let's get this. All right, so Steven, you're gonna be the dress thrower. Ready, guys? All he's doing is throwing the dress. Tell me when you're ready. Okay. Good, all right, ready? 1, 2, and 3. Whoa, nope, gotta throw it up, wrong way. Hold on, 1, 2, and 3. There we go. All right, so not this one, next one. Because the sparkle starts to pick up. So you start to see that. But it's only a little bit of sparkle. So here's your next step. I could use a longer shutter speed to let see you, so you see more streak, right? It moves longer. Or I can zoom my lens. Because when I zoom my lens, Now it gives more streaks. So watch the difference. You'll see what I'm talking about here. I'm gonna use a little bit longer. Okay, hold on. All right, ready, Steven? Mm-hmm. 1, 2, and 3. Now it's like on fire and the dress moves in every way, shape, and form, and it looks like it's exploding. And it's really cool. So to translate to where you may have seen this before, I don't know if you've ever seen maybe fashion ads where you see like streaks of the glitter in the makeup, or maybe jewelry and you see that streak, or maybe it sparkles on a dress, it's something. So right now, the beauty dish freezes her in place. The modeling light is what's lighting the bottom of her dress. I'm gonna do one more, and this is my complicated setup. I'm gonna do one more thing, just to make this a little more complicated. Let's zoom in. Oh no, she's a little out of focus. Does anyone know why? Okay, but technically, someone said zooming, you're trying to focus on her at the same time. But technically, she should be frozen in place from the beauty dish. Right? Because she's not being lit the entire time of the exposure. The beauty dish is supposed to freeze her in place. So even if I zoom, it should be fine. Okay, so it's two things. Beauty dish has a modeling light. The modeling light's staying on, and that's what's giving you the blur. Because that light's still on her face, so you move the camera, and that light on her face is what's recording. So you would have to turn off the modeling light and watch for this bill. So just turn off the modeling light real quick. And you're watching for this extra spill. So, one more time. So this should be better. So I'm gonna do one last shot and then we'll move on from this. Okay, here we go. Beautiful, hold on. Let me make sure, I gotta grab her focus on her face without any light. Okay, ready? 1, 2, and 3. Yeah, it's good, okay. Of course, any light in this room is going to make it a little blurry, so it's going to be a lot sharper, but there's miscellaneous light, so I can like pump this up, can fill in the shadows, I can shift the color, I can sharpen it up, but it's cool, creative, and in camera. So if you were going to do this on your own for, let's say, speed light setup, what you would do is, first of all, you don't have to worry about the modeling light anymore. Right? So that's not gonna record. So you could use a rapid box, for example. They also make grids, that focus light that go on the front of these speed light modifiers. I mean, you could use Rogue, Expo Imaging. Rogue makes grids, really focus lights. You could just do that on the face. But then for your bottom light, any sort of hot light. Like it could be like the ones that they warm up chickens with, the eggs, right? Like you could use that pointed at the bottom of the dress and it would do the same thing. Or if you have a strobe, turn on the modeling light, something to that effect. So this is constant light here and studio strobe mixed. If you're a beginner to lighting, that should be, if I were a good teacher, it shouldn't be complicated, but it's complicated. Like that's not something really beginner. So if you are just new to studio strobes, don't feel overwhelmed. Definitely go back and revisit that tutorial I mentioned. But this is something to give those of you who are more advanced, just like a taste of what you can do in camera. I would say, are there any questions? However, that's a super complicated one. And I wanna get a couple more things in. So can we bring up the house lights again? I am going to do two more things. All right, first of all, let's get rid of this one. Let's do the projector, and then I'll have you get Johnny for the last one. Okay? Great. Okay, so let me just unplug this. We're gonna reset briefly. All right, so I wanted to make sure there's something for everyone, and this particular demonstration is for the people that have everything. Okay, like I'm talking like I say some obscure modifier, you're like, I've got it. And I say like, oh, 3 strobes, and you're like, I've got it, I've got 5, I've got whatever. I wanted to show you one thing to play with. There are very unusual modifiers that have very limited application, but they're super cool. Now, this is something that is building on our very first shot. Remember our very first shot with that umbrella, casting the patterns on the face. Okay, well, this is the same idea, but go from $12 to $1,000. But you have more control. Okay, so what this one is called, this is called a spot projector. And different brands make them, and they fit on a studio strobe. And what they allow you to do, can I grab that real quick? And do you have more of them? Okay, what they allow you to do is you can buy any shape you want and project it onto the face. And in fact, I have a very lovely boyfriend that bought me my logo that I can project onto things. So he said, listen, if you want to brand your models, I can do that. So I should have branded you. How did I not brand you yet? I just shot her like 5 times in the last week.
Or him.
Or I could brand you, yeah. Or him. So I've got everything from dots, okay, to floral swirls. You know, I'm not sure really the applicability of floral swirls, to a vertical line. Like, so there's so many different ones. Like I said, I also have my logo. I know that here at B&H, they have like a core kit of like circle, like the essential ones that are not as weird as these. Okay, but they definitely have this one. And this particular one's called Profoto Spot Small, in case you're curious. So what I'm gonna take here is I'm gonna take a V shape. And I am going to just show you what this looks like. What this does is you can slide into the front of it, whatever shape you choose, and it will project it onto the face. But also, I have the ability to focus that beam. So if I want it to be a super, super sharp V, I can zoom it out. You might need to rotate it if you have it in the wrong place. There you go. I have a super, super sharp V. Or if I unfocus it, I'll just have a soft beam of light down the middle of the face. So years ago, I saw this Calvin Klein ad where I had this guy with his watch on, and there was like a beam of light down his face. And I was like, how did they do this? How they did it? They had one of these. Because I thought it was natural light, but there was too much control. By the way, if you like to shoot constant lights, if you're more of a constant light person, they have something called a Dato light. They have one downstairs. They're just very expensive. So I said $12 or $1,000, but you can do more things.
All right. Sharp or not?
That's fine for now. All right, so, and let me switch my lens. So I'm gonna switch over to a 70-200. 70-200 is my go-to beauty lens. And that's what I use for close-up shots. I don't need to be, right there. I don't need to be any closer than, you know, I don't need to be at a 180 macro because I'm not going really close. I still wanna see the pattern. But I had on my 24-70 because in my last one, I was zooming my lens, right? So now, I'm gonna get a tighter up beauty shot. Looks great. Oh, wait, wrong exposure, hold up. I was set on what was before. Didn't set my shutter speed back to where it should be. So, okay. So let's go back to where my shutter speed should be and put it right on her eye, Steven. Hold still for me, hon. And get it over the other eye. Go, no, to the right eye. Okay, and now sharpen it up for me. So don't move. So he's gonna do a really sharp line. First, perfect. That's great. Perfect. Okay, I'm in the way. So I've got this like really beautiful sharp line across your face. And then what I could do is I can change it to black and white if I wanted to, make it super high contrast. If I wanted to add more lights, I could add a rim light to the side of her neck so that she stands out and doesn't blend into the background. Do one more soft just so you can see the difference. And one more, perfect. And here's when we've softened that line. It gets bigger and the edges get less defined. Okay, it's like softens up the edges. All right, so real quick, can you grab Johnny? Is Johnny in the back? Okay, Johnny, I'm gonna bring you up here. Can you put the bag under, and you're gonna put this on. Just trust me, because you'll get dirty. All right, and also wig off. No flower. Okay, Johnny, I'm gonna bring you up here. All right, so the reason that I wanted to do those last two demonstrations was more or less to let you know the more complicated you could go, right? You can go in more of a complicated direction for using in-camera techniques, using creative lighting. But I did want to show you one more thing that does not require expensive gear, does not matter the lighting you use. You can use window light, you could use a speed light, you could use a studio strobe. But it's about the prop or the tool that you use. So I've got them over here. And Johnny, I'm going to give it to you. Just, yeah, and Steven, put this over here as well. Good. Great. Okay. Here, and then this one is what he's going to open up. Just put a lot on it. Okay, but it's going to be dirty. Start with one color first. Okay, so here's what I've got. I went on Amazon.com, and I went and bought something called Holy Powder, H-O-L-I. And Holy Powder is what they use in the Indian Festival of Color, but also here in the United States when people do the runs and they throw the color runs at them, okay? What it is it's, not, I mean, it's non-toxic, okay? I wouldn't eat it, right? All right, but it's different colored powder. And so I'm gonna open up a box, but it is super messy. That's why we laid down some garbage bags. I also got one here if you can't get it open. Okay. Let's see how messed up this one is. Oh dear. Okay, so there's one that opened up in here. Oh, here, just use the orange for now. Okay. So notice. Okay. Can you grab me some paper towels already?
Yeah.
Try not to get it on their floor because it's not super fun to get out. Okay. So here are the things that I recommend. Just go across. All right. So what he's going to do is he's going to add texture to her face. But I always ask myself, what am I drawn to in this picture? What am I inspired by? And I am inspired by the texture and the color. So for me, if I'm inspired by the texture or the color, I don't need the hair. I don't need the whole body. I want close up. Like I want to see that texture and color. So that's why I'm going to use a macro lens. What are you grabbing? No, just go ask them to get. Can you guys get me a paper towel? Perfect. Lovely. Okay, can you put a beauty dish on there? So he's going to put some of this powder on her face, and she's going to keep her eyes closed until it's on. I gave her an old T-shirt. Great. I just need some for my hands for the camera. Perfect. Thank you. And we're going to switch back to a beauty dish. Whatever light source you have is fine. If you use a little bit of a harder light source as opposed to a soft, you'll see more texture. Softer light sources hide texture. Harder light sources add texture. But this is when the Canon 180 macro lens is going to be awesome because I'll be able to get a ton of detail. Okay, let me look back down at me. Good? Yeah, just squish her around her eyelashes a little. Perfect. Great. And then Johnny, can you reach into there and pick one more? I'm going to do this shot first. And then, good, okay. And I need, oh, well, there you go. Okay, get this one for me. Switch, okay. All right, so Johnny, I'm gonna have you step to the back once you found the color you want. And can you give him those scissors? All right, now, can you turn to your left for me? And Johnny, you're gonna go that way.
Okay, behind her?
Yes. All right, so you're great. I'm going to take a picture of her eye and turn your chin towards me. All right, and let me just make sure, what's the power settings on that?
7.
Perfect, okay. So watch, perfect, look your eye here. Great. Oh, so pretty, okay. So, beautiful texture. Okay, let's see how focused I am. It's like, oh yeah, I'm good. Look at that. Right? Beautiful color, beautiful texture. Love it. So this is a Canon 5DS, right? This is what shooting 50 megapixel gets you. I can see, look at the size, even the shadows of those eyelashes. I can see the texture on the outside of everyone. All right, you can add the second color. I'm gonna take one more shot of that, and then I'll wrap everything up for you. So again, this whole box, which contains a ton of colors, was $20. So here, the in-camera creativity is the prop or the styling, but this you don't need a makeup artist. Johnny's wonderful. He's incredible, but you can sprinkle powder on someone's face, right? You know, poor creative. I just didn't want to get my hands dirty. Love you, Johnny. See, he loves me too, it's okay. He's gonna get it all. He's gonna put it in his beard, and yeah, we're good. All right. Oh yeah, lovely. You want to do one more of those, and we're good. Don't throw it too far, because I don't want to. Good. Yeah. Okay, great. All right. So watch the bottom of your shoes too much. Okay? All right. So here we go, babe. Turn your chin way down. Way, way, way down. Right there. Beautiful. And close your eyes for one. Close your eyes again. And chin down a little bit and chin back towards me. Right there. Yeah. It's beautiful. Do one more real close. Eyes closed again. All right. Here's why I wanted to do that. Let's see when I've nailed the focus. Try the next one. Let's see, I think it's the next one. Yeah, this one, try this one. Let's see. Yeah, cool, right? Super cool. And it's thinking, go to the, yeah. So I can get so much, like tack sharp focus on those eyelashes and get all of that detail. So, Stephen, will you assist this? And I'm going to go over here to do my wrap up, okay? All right. So, thanks, guys. All right, so just kind of to give you a little summary of what we just did, but in some of the other pictures I've taken before. So you can do it, to get creative, you can do in camera with tools and props. So I talked about the mirrors. We looked at this, right? We looked at the three mirrors, $10. Or when you zoom out to 24 millimeters. This was through the crystals. Again, more through the crystals. And then here's shots with holy powder. And so I can get all of that detail in a macro shot on the eyes. That one was shot with the 180. This one was shot with, on the left with an 85. I will tell you, after I took the shot on the left, I realized that there are two colors out of the holy powder boxes that stain the skin. Red and magenta, for your knowledge. However, I blame him because he goes into the bathroom afterwards, and instead of brushing it off, he splashes his face with water, and it soaked right in. Okay. And then here's an example of how I've used that parasol for a beauty shot. So those are all involving props or things that you are inexpensive that you can add to the scene or make yourself. So that's one way to be creative. And if you can shake out the dress when you're done, that'd be awesome. Okay, number two would be in-camera creative techniques. So things that have to do with your camera settings. And so one of those things would be what we talked about in the very beginning, multiple exposures. So multiple exposures in camera. And so I've done this with real flowers, fake flowers, maternity. It's beautiful. Here's another one, which is a combination of your camera settings and a prop holding those bubbles, the sparkly gems on clear plastic, whatever you want to formally call those. The light has to catch them, but it's your camera setting being at a wide aperture and having it close to the camera that gives you this effect. So I've shot this several times. And this is, I shot on a tungsten white balance, which made it bluer, which is, this is pretty much what it looked like in camera. And then here's an example of using constant light and studio strobe to blur. So this is the shot that if you go to learn.lindsayadlerphotography.com, if you go to that site, this is the tutorial. You see this shot being made and several others like it if you want to watch. Here's another shot where I had a strobe freeze her, and then instead of using the constant light to get something sparkly, I move the camera and it creates an interesting blur that looks ghostly off of her body. But it's the same kind of concept. And then the third approach, besides setting your camera techniques or having interesting props, would be creative lighting. So this is a shot that I took, and look at how long the exposure is. It's a 42-second exposure because it's paint with light. So it's a completely pitch dark room, no light whatsoever. And then I would take LED colored pen lights. If you're in a pitch dark room, and I trace over her face once with the pen light, as long as I don't trace over it again, it doesn't matter how much she moves because it'll never be lit again, so it won't be recorded. So what I made sure I did is only trace over her eye once, and that kept it in tack sharp focus. If you actually look at the hair where I went over it multiple times, it's super blurry, but it looks like movement. It's completely fine. So this is actually the cover of my fourth book. My fifth book comes out February 1st, and it is Posing to Flatter Everyone. So I've got maternity, you know, curves or plus size. I've got family, all of that. So that'll be my next book in February. This is a take on the gel that I had in the beginning, that cut out plastic. I shot this editorial, I believe it was for Marie Claire, Indonesia, I think was the editorial I shot this in. I could be lying, it might have been El Bulgaria, I don't know. One of these publications. But this is holding a gel, but it's actually in the frame. But it doesn't bother you. But unless you have hard light, you won't get those lines. But it's creative lighting, but it's usually just really just using that gel. Or I've done this with that last thing we did, using the spot projection, but to create film noir blinds across the face. Or one other thing you could try, which we did not do, would be a black light. There's too much light in this room for me to be able to have it really show up well, but you can buy a $20 black light on Amazon and then buy UV powder, UV paint, UV eyelashes, like anything that you want, and get creative that way. So looking at all of these things, kind of my takeaway, my summary of what I would want you all to consider is, first take a look at your style, if you have one. Figure out what images mean the most to you, and then figure out if there's some kind of repeated patterns in those, and try to cultivate and develop that style. But an important part of figuring out your voice and style and growing is not being afraid to experiment, and also accepting that you are, in fact, creative. So I've given you a variety of different techniques to get creative in camera, even if you don't know Photoshop, whether you're shooting with window light, a single speed light, multiple speed lights, or studio strobes. So there really is no excuse for not getting extremely creative. So thank you everybody for joining me this afternoon.
Whether you're a hobbyist or a professional, B&H has the answers to your questions. Experience a world of technology at our New York City Superstore. Connect with us online or give us a call. Our staff of experts is happy to help.